How is it that some meaningless squiggles, your brain's squiggle generator, makes your physical body get up and close the door because your dog was barking?
Yes.
Where does action connect to abstraction?
That is the key question. That I believe that's what we need to solve. That's sort of what the field of linguistics, or whatever we want to call it, maybe even cognition, needs to solve, because these mappings are happening. What we know from the large language models is you don't need that in order to be proficient in language. So this is where we have to start from. That's the starting point, that the language can live on its own. And you can learn language, in theory, you can learn language independent of any of that stuff. The ability to make somebody get up and move, the ability for me to reason about perceptual phenomena. Language is able to be mastered entirely based on its own structure, the meaningless squiggles. Now, the question you're raising is what I think is sort of that's what we need to do as a species, to, if we want to understand scientifically what language, how language really works, is to understand how you go from an autonomous self-generating system that has its own rules, its own self-generative rules, and that are determined simply by relations between these meaningless squiggles, and how does that then get mapped to meaning, to the ability for me to use some of those tokens and then get you to do stuff, right? And so that's what language learning is there. So there's going to be, I guess we can think of almost two, maybe even independent processes. One is learn how words play with one another.
Okay.
Learn that this word tends to be in relation to that word.
Okay, that one's solved.
Yes.
As far as you're concerned. Got it.
Okay. Then we also learn about perceptual phenomena, right? We learn that there's things on top of other things, and there are actions we want to take, the things that my dog understands. Now, the question is, how do these things bridge? How do you get from tokens that have their own life of their own, sort of relational properties amongst one another, to that other representation, that other way of encoding, let's say facts over the world. Facts about the world is, even that's saying too much. It's just another brain state, right? Brain state that has perceptual information.
Hold on. Facts about the world is just another brain state, or the world is another brain state?
So all we've got is brain states, right? And it's sort of the inherent, this is fact number one about like what we've learned about ourselves as a species. We have perceptual brain states. We also have maybe linguistic brain states. Those perceptual brain states are in some ways related to what's going on in the world. Potentially, we can think about them as being related to what you can do in the world as well. And so maybe actions, well, we have brain states that correspond to our proprioception, our muscles, where, things having to do with our own body. And so there's these various brain states that carry, we could think of them as carrying information. The reason I'm worried about using that phrase is because, again, I don't believe in sort of a one-to-one simple correspondence where we say this particular brain state corresponds to, this perceptual kind of phenomenon in the world, or some state of the world, because it's probably not that simple. It's probably closer to this potentialities, right? There's some sort of activity that's due to my perceptual system that my brain can do things with and engage with in some way. And so, but what we do have is these brain states that are derived from distinct sources of information, sensory perceptual, and then linguistic. Linguistic gets there, by the way, through sensory perceptual. We're not going to get into that, right? We're thinking of symbols as being kind of arbitrary. Yes, you have to hear the word cat and you have to hear the word dog. But I think we have good reason to say now, it's just like large language models, that these are kind of arbitrary symbols with the relations between them. That's what matters. Okay, so you've got these kind of distinct brain states, which in some ways, again, this is philosophically fraught, but in some ways represent facts about the world, perhaps, but I don't really want to go that far. But you've got these brain states that need to talk to each other so that they can coordinate. And that is sort of the key fundamental problem that our organism has to solve. And it's not just like, of course, you're not born having the linguistic You're not born having the linguistic mapping all solved. You have to learn that. But you are born into a world where it's already been solved, meaning we've got these corpus of language, the thing that the large language models were trained on. That pre-existed the models, just as when a baby's born, the English language pre-exists the baby. You can learn the mappings, and I believe you do.
Mm-hmm.
You can learn the embedding space of language without the other stuff, right? That's sort of the key insight from large language models. So that already contained within the linguistic system that we've honed over however many years it took for humans to develop language, we've honed a system that has this utility built in, such that it's a good thing to dump into that latent space so that when a baby hears the word ball, sees this object that's a ball, gets that mapping. But again, the word ball is really meaningful, it really has its own role in relation to other words. But you, over the course of development, you also learn this kind of, what I think is maybe a latent space bridge or some other bridge between these. And so in the end, you end up being able to tell somebody, go pick up that ball. And of course, they're able to go and do it. But you're really engaging very distinct mechanisms that have some way of bridging, which is, it's a non-answer. I'm not going to pretend that is, even halfway to a solution. But I do think it's a sketch of how the cognitive architecture ultimately really is built. I think that we've now nailed down one piece, the linguistic piece, and we're able to say this is how it lives and this is how it operates, and it is autonomous. And then we don't have something similar for perceptual space and for motor space. We don't have something comparable. We haven't been able to capture it successfully. Maybe in robotics, that's happening. I don't know, but that's the kind of thing, that the work that needs to get done.
So maybe this is a solved problem, but as it stands with ChatGPT and Claude and so on, they're fixed models and they're producing some output, but it's not as if when they're speaking to one another, they then retrain their model in real time. And it would seem like that's more like what's occurring with us. So maybe that's just a technology.
Are you referring to like different language models just chatting with one another?
No, I mean, even us right now, we're learning concepts from exchanging it with one another, and we're producing new ones, and we're deleting old ones, potentially modifying old ones, recontextualizing. It doesn't seem like that's occurring with Gemini 06-05.
Great question. And people, this is sort of one of the key challenges, saying of the sort of the identity hypothesis that we're doing the same thing, which is sort of continuous learning. And so there are two things that happen in large language models that we can call learning. And one is the actual shaping of the space, which is really just determining, the connectivity between neurons. Again, you can think of it as a graph, or you can think of it as sort of just an embedding of determining the embedding. But whatever it is, that happens during the course of training. And that's kind of done offline. And
yes.
So that's training the model. There's also fine tuning, which is just more of the same. You have some new data you want to incorporate into the weights of the model. That's actually going to, again, change the shape of the space, if you want to think about it that way. And then there's something called in-context learning. And in-context learning is where you're in the middle of a chat and you say, hey, ChatGPT, let me teach you a new word. It's global. And global is that feeling you get when, you're tired, but you know you have to keep working or whatever.
Okay,
and ChatGPT can use that word very successfully.
I got global up the wazoo.
Sure you do. You suffer from extreme global. You were able to just, use that word. ChatGPT can do that too. And it's sort of there was a paper about this early on in the chat wars. I don't remember who put out the paper, but it was about the shocking generalizability. The in-context learning seems to just be too good to be true. But lo and behold, that's what happens. And that is happening in the autoregression. It's happening even though this model has never seen global,
right.
Even though it's never encountered that word before. But here it shows up in the sequence. And now through the autoregressive process, as it's churning through the longer sequence with this word in it, it's now able to predict sort of the next token in the appropriate way so that it's using that term correctly. So we do actually see this kind of continuous learning in the case of these models. However, it's happening in context. And what that means is, you know, from a practical standpoint, yeah. is if you start a new chat window,
yes,
it doesn't
yes.
know that word anymore.
So what would be the analogy here? Is context, window length, our working memory? Like what's the actual...
Great question. Yes, that is what I truly believe. And this is a different line of research, but with some caveats. So yes, in my conception, what we call long-term memory is just fine-tuning of the weights. It's an information that gets embedded in the actual weights of the model. So the static model, we can think of it, when it's not actually in the process of autoregressively generating. Working memory is literally the autoregression.
So what would the analogy for RAG be then?
What would the role for RAG be? Okay, so this is where I'm at right now. Does the brain actually do anything like retrieval? I've decided to stake out the extreme view that our brain doesn't do retrieval at all. That all we do is fine tuning and then next token generation autoregressively. And we don't actually ever retrieve per se, that we don't ever actually have to do anything like RAG. RAG is a transitional technology. I don't believe long-term that we're going to have to do something like that. We're going to have something like a stored database and then a search. One of the reasons I believe this is because that's not how our brains work. We don't do that. Cognition doesn't work that way. We may sometimes sit there pondering and trying to recall a fact, but when we're doing that, we're not actually searching a space. It's either we're running some sort of chain of thought where we're like, okay, I remember I was doing this and I'm trying to actually produce the appropriate sequence in working memory such that it'll pop out. The right fact will pop out from the autoregressive process. Sometimes we just find ourselves trying to remember something. There's the tip of the tongue phenomenon. The reason why tip of the tongue phenomenon, I believe, is so frustrating is not because we're searching, we're actually running some sort of search retrieval process. It's because part of our brain actually is running the auto-generative process, and we kind of can feel like the word, we can almost generate, we can produce it, but it's short-circuited somehow, and we can't do the full generation. So my hypothesis is that we don't have anything like RAG. All we've got is this, and it's in some ways a very simple and I think elegant model. All we've got is fine tuning. And that's what we can call memory consolidation. That happens after the fact over the course of minutes and weeks and months and years. Kind of consolidation is fine tuning the weights. And then we have the autoregressive workspace, which is this conversation you and I are having right now. It's not working memory. I'll tell you what, I don't, working memory in the way it's cognitive psychology has thought about it for many years, I frankly think is erroneous. It's not this super time duration limited, 7 seconds or 15 seconds. And after that, it's a cliff and you don't remember anything. That's what happens when you have to directly, explicitly retrieve. Like, what was the last word I said? Tell me the exact sequence of letters or numbers. Mm-hmm. That's not something our brain actually has to do regularly. Instead, what we're seeing in working memory, we can do that. We can do retrieval of the last 7 seconds, but that's because we have continuous context. And there is a decay function, unlike the large language models, which represent everything in whole blocks. Although I think some of the newer models, these endless context models, are probably doing something similar. But we don't remember we don't actually have literally the exact tokens that were expressed 10 minutes ago. But what we do have is some sort of continuous activation that's similar, where it's not retrieval, it's guiding. It's the past is guiding the generation. And so what you and I talked about an hour ago, I don't know how long we've been going here, probably a while. I don't know how much global global you've got going on, right? It's been a while. So those tokens that we were expressed, an hour ago, are still guiding the generation now. Now they're doing so less than the last 10 seconds. We could think about it as kind of a decay function of some sort where they're having less impact. We see that in the models too, by the way. If you look at the attention weights, words that are farther apart have less impact on one another. That is a direct reflection of the fact that language is human generated and humans do this, right? We the words that we spoke about a few seconds ago are more impactful on the words that we're going to say than we spoke about an hour ago. But the idea is, yes, that what we've got is this. I don't use the term working memory because I think that's very fraught with like the modal model that's been in vogue for a long time, or working memory model. Baddeley and all these folks, they were really thinking of this very short duration, time limited. Boom. No, this is continuous activation, namely context. And the context, I don't know how far back it goes. Right? And this is an empirical question. Does it operate over hours? Does it operate over days? Is there a continuous activation, a more dynamical form of memory that's happening? That's not the same thing as long-term memory, because long-term memory...
So memory is not a database in your model.
Like, memory is not a database, correct. What memory in my model is there's two things. Memory is the fixed weights. Of the neural network, which can represent, they don't represent facts, they represent potentialities. Those fixed weights are, what does that mean? It means if you give it a certain input, it's going to produce a certain output, right? Just like a large language model. If I say to it, well, tell me the, you know, recite the Pledge of Allegiance, it will say, here is the Pledge of Allegiance, right? For next token, it's going to be out is here, whatever. But then it'll actually say the Pledge of Allegiance. And all of that is a potentiality that's embedded, that's encoded in the weights. But the weights, you're not going to find that fact in the weights. It's the weights are there as potentialities, ready for whatever input comes their way. They're going to produce this input, this output.
Okay.
So that's the weights, and then you've got the running sequence. And the running sequence, and we see this from in context learning, but it's the core autoregressive process. The sequence itself is a different thing than the stored weights, right? Because first you've got the stored weights are just the static situation, and given this input, I'm going to produce this output. Then we actually do it. You give it an input, it produces a certain output. It takes that output, tacks it on to the sequence. Now it's going to keep going.
As you know, on Theories of Everything, we delve into some of the most reality-spiraling concepts, from theoretical physics and consciousness to AI and emerging technologies. To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of TOE, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/TOE, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.